We are here today with the immediate former president of PSK, who is an entrepreneur in his own right, and we'd like to just delve into the issues of enterprise in health. So, Doctor, how has it been since you left office?
Father, it has been good. I've been relaxed, almost on the time.
Yeah.
Yes, and just concentrate on my business. Yes.
Okay. And we've been seeing that you've been, from our members, that you've been really hiring a lot of these pharmacists who have finished internship and also taking more on training or internship. How has that been for you?
Okay, yeah, that's true. We are a major internship center for the community level because there are not so many community pharmacists who are practicing nowadays. I think we are less than 300. So at any particular time, pharmacy and poison board normally sends me 3 interns.
Mm-hmm.
That means it's a shortage because each facility may be supposed to have one.
Mm-hmm.
So it has been interesting, at least training them. They are taking up very well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're saying less than 300 pharmacists in community pharmacy,
mm-hmm.
and we have almost 400 unemployed pharmacists. What are we missing there? What is the issue there?
What has happened for when us guys we are graduating, that is 2001, all the way up to I think 2003-04,
yeah.
When the salaries in government started improving, then when they started improving from 2005, almost everyone was graduated since then. As they went to government, stuck there, the money is good, working environment, maybe the working hours are flexible, not as tight as private sector. So my lot of pharmacists stuck there. So in the community pharmacy we don't have nowadays maybe in terms of salary it might not be paying the same as the government.
Mm-hmm.
So the what we see now with that one, many pharmacists, the young ones, they even the ones in campus, according to them, when they want to graduate they go work in government, the salary is good, but they're not focusing on private sector.
Mm-hmm.
And private sector, mainly community pharmacy, is okay, first you can sell as an employed pharmacist, but later you can be an entrepreneur.
Mm.
And now the hard part is that entrepreneurship, not only for young farmers, even for older farmers, it's not something for everyone.
Mm.
It needs a lot of mentorship and courage to go there.
Yeah. You've been practicing community pharmacy how many years now?
Wow, community pharmacy continuously. Okay, I did from graduation 2001, the first 3 years I did community pharmacy after internship always I was in government. After that I went to community pharmacy for 2 years, after that I went to Mata Hospital, that's still maybe community stroke hospital pharmacy, for another 2 years. Then I did 2 years in the industry, manufacturing. Then since then, from 2010, I've been 2011, been full-time in business now. I set up my first community pharmacy in 2010. I set up the outpatient center in 2011. So in full-time business, that's now from 2011.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you have an interesting setup here where you have almost like a team approach to healthcare.
Mm.
Yeah. And how was that journey? What made you choose that option?
First, when I set up my business in Kileleshwa, by coincidence, when I completed my internship, that time I was staying in KNH, the sister's mess there.
Mm-hmm.
So when I left sister's mess, the next estate I went to, now, actually outside now, the university at KNH came to Kileleshwa. So that time I was single, staying in a bedsitter.
Mm-hmm.
And since then, from 2002, I've now left Kileleshwa. So I came to study what was lacking in Kileleshwa. So first, I came to know that Kileleshwa was lacking first of all, a community pharmacy. So the first time I got some capital which accumulated over time through employment in 2010, I set up a late night pharmacy which was lacking.
Mm.
So it did very well, broke even within 6 months.
Mm.
So those are some of the things the young pharmacists can look at. There are places where you go, first study the opportunity, see like how I set up that pharmacy. One day it was around 7 p.m. in Kileleshwa, and that time now my child needed Calpo.
Mm.
And in Kilalesh, I realized the only pharmacy which was open was there then in Kilalesh, which had been there for quite some time, the shopping center. The shopping center closed at 6 p.m. So at 7 p.m., we couldn't get you. You have to go all the way to town to get a simple product like Calco. That's just for fever. So I saw this as an opportunity. That's the time people have come from work, from town. They find the children having fever like that. So they didn't have a place to go. So when immediately I set up, and they started opening from 7 a.m. to midnight. And the old pharmacy, they were opening 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. That's how the people are very happy. So I was filling up a gap which was there, and no one had filled it. So it broke even very fast. Then the medical center, when you set up the pharmacy, we realized there are no... Actually, we started getting a lot of emergencies coming. Like, for example, you're in the house, maybe you're chopping vegetable, then you cut yourself. So all those people used to land in the pharmacy, bleeding fingers, all that. Some of them even road accidents. So people just think, where can they get a health person? So they land at the pharmacy, and obvious that we didn't have the facilities to handle such emergency. We could just maybe, if it's a small cut, help in stopping bleeding or that, and then tell them proceed to the nearest hospital. So we realized there was no actually a prescriber or a medical facility apart from not my standalone pharmacy, which was open. So that's another gap we realized. So also I stumbled on it by actually seeing that gap. And having worked in, sometimes it's good to work for some years or something, having worked in Mata Hospital, I knew the operations of a hospital and where the margins were. So, and that's actually how I ended up deciding to open up. First of all, it was filling a gap which was not there. Up to today, we are the only place in Kilalesh where you can get a prescribing doctor, even in Kilalesh. Yeah. So we are filling that gap. The other thing, you could see the population. When I was moving to Kilalesh in 2002, the population of Kilalesh was low because all these flats you are seeing, most of them were bungalows then. So most of them, I've seen them come up. So the population has been a place where there was a bungalow with maybe two elderly people, their children have grown and gone away like that. Nowadays, those bungalows came down and an apartment. At first, up to 5 years ago, the apartments were going up to four floors. So from one single dwelling to almost 30 middle income people, young families like that. So population improved. Nowadays they're going to, most of apartments being done now, from the last 3-4 years, they're going to 10, 15 floors.
Yeah.
Population is going up.
Yeah.
So, and with that we've seen a rise in, even in our customer flows.
Okay, that's interesting. It's interesting to just listen to that journey and reflect. I know the country is trying to mirror what is happening in Cuba.
Yes.
But if when I listen to your story, you're actually embedded in this community. You're almost the primary pharmaceutical caregiver in this community.
Yeah.
What are these services that you offer? Yeah, you talked about emergency care. So what are these things?
Okay, so the Askeleto Medical Plaza, which now, instead of, as I told you, it's a standalone pharmacy, now it's a comprehensive medical center. We offer various services. One, there's an outright consultation where a patient can walk in, they see a doctor. This here we work as it's a comprehensive team with a medical doctor, and at a particular time there's a pharmacist, I'm always there. We always have a nurse, a laboratory person. Okay, so we do consultation, including emergencies. Sometimes, let me just start with consultation. Then we do lab. We have a very well equipped lab. Almost, I think we do almost all the tests you can get done in any of the big hospitals. Maybe almost 95%. We do them here. Then there is obviously the pharmacy. The pharmacy is the ones who get prescription for medicine. You get it. Also, there are people who work directly from outside. They come and do consultation at the pharmacy level. So we also recommend for them medicine and they go out with them. We also have, just to mention, we do physiotherapy, we have a physiotherapy unit. We are also among the few facilities in Nairobi and also in Kenya where we do speech therapy for children who have autism and also adults who have I've lost speech due to strokes and all that. Yeah. Then recently last year we set up an audiology unit. So we do hearing testing and also fixing of the hearing aids. So those are the major services. But at the pharmacy level, as you said, we are there in terms of, actually, you always say that I'm the estate pharmacies or doctor.
Yeah.
So almost everyone in Kilesha, he knows this is where they can get comprehensive care. Mm-hmm. So especially for pharmacies, we do a lot of what's called now this MTM, mm-hmm. chronic care, like the patients on chronic care, diabetes, hypertension, they have a combination of medicines. We've come to know pharmacy has a big intervention point to be able to meet these patients and analyze the drugs they're taking and the side effects. And we've come to discover that most of those people, they actually, some of the drugs are giving them side effects, they don't know even their side effects. So those side effects have ended up developing to be even some extra disease conditions which needed intervention. Mm-hmm. And we've really actually intervened in several patients to advising them that this product is what's causing side effect, so we advise them to go see their prescriber or they see a prescriber here for a switch, mm-hmm. and it has really done very well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, that's cool. So it's good. It's interesting to see you take that journey from 2010 to now we are 2018. So there's a young pharmacist there who's listening and wondering, where do you get? What are the options?
Mm-hmm.
What are the options that are available to me to set up my pharmacy in my community, in Madari? You know, how do I go and get embedded there and start running a pharmacy? What are the, and of course the big question is around cost.
Yes.
How do you deal with that?
Okay, first of all, if you're that pharmacy, the young pharmacies, some of them are saying they are employed, maybe the government has not posted them. Mm-hmm. Instead of sitting at home waiting to be posted, even, forget about Nairobi, go back to your village. Especially with devolution, there are so many opportunities. According to me, most of the county headquarters, there is a lot of opportunities there because there are the people who are spending power there, they have increased over time. So they need to go there and first of all do a market analysis. What is in the health sector? What is lacking? Like the pharmacy, standalone pharmacy, community pharmacy, or even linking up with their, we also hearing, apart from pharmacy, the medical doctors are also, there are several even more, mm-hmm. they're even more unemployed.
Mm-hmm.
If they can partner that to set up a comprehensive care center, there's a lot of opportunity on that, especially in, now NHIF cover is being, many people are being recruited to NHIF,
mm-hmm.
and many people will be going to places where there's comprehensive care centers than just standalone pharmacies.
Mm-hmm.
But even standalone pharmacies, I find there are so many opportunities, only that people, first of all, they might still be thinking opportunities only in Nairobi. Nairobi might be saturated or not, but there are several sections of Nairobi which are not yet saturated. But I've been advising young people, forget about Nairobi, just go back to your county. Look at the county, the towns around there, and they do a market research. Find out even you, like me, my business started by what was I lacking. If me, I was lacking that as a consumer, that means the community was lacking.
Okay.
Yeah, I lacked a place to buy, in Kilesha to buy car at 7:30 p.m.
Mm.
So I saw this must be a big problem to many people who have to drive all the way to town.
Mm.
We lacked a place to, when we opened the hospital, emergencies or the pharmacy, emergencies were landing there. That means people are lacking a place that can, emergencies can be handled. And here we really have to handle a lot of emergencies, especially accidents. A lot of construction, people who maybe get knocked and then they come here, we do a lot of, sometimes a lot of suturing and all that. So my advice to them is that they need to go and look for the opportunity. Don't just sit at home and wait to be posted. It might not be coming soon. So if it's another kind and you have all this expertise, you've been trained, don't stay at home, utilize that. And about capital, first of all, it is cheaper to invest in the outside Nairobi. Nairobi is still might be expensive because of rental. Rentals are high. Almost everything is expensive. But you find in the counties, you might find a good premises for setting up even a standalone pharmacy for almost a rent of 3,000. Mm-hmm. And the initial stock might not be that much. Mm-hmm. If you team up, you might even start, or even you can approach, mm-hmm. get some bank loan and start.
So for you, I hear a lot of teamwork, but for you, you actually run this place, you capitalize it yourself,
yes.
and you're able to, were you employed when you started?
Yes, from the time I graduated 2001, I said I worked 2 years in community pharmacy, 2 years in hospital, actually hospital, I did 2 years in Dow Limited. All that time because I've always wanted to start business, but I struggled to raise capital. So with time I accumulated by small earnings. So in 2010 I started the standalone pharmacy. Then later the standalone pharmacy is what now helped me capitalize. This facility in the initial stages. Also got a bank loan to equip it. Equipping a facility like this it's not that cheap. So like the lab costs money, also the equipping the hospital and also running costs to be able to initially before the client get to know about the place to pay the doctors and the nurses and all that. That's what actually required extra capital. So actually it was financed through also a bank loan, but initially most banks want to find you having started. Okay. No bank will finance you from Greenfield, or very few will leave the end.
Yeah. So I hear from you just step by step, from
step to by step.
Get that hospital immediately, so just starting somewhere.
Yeah.
So if maybe then I can come to this, what's your biggest challenge in running this place? In making healthcare affordable, you know, we're talking about UHC, making it affordable. Then the question is, is it sustainable for you? Or what is this, what are your challenges that you'd like to pause and see if we can discuss and get solutions for?
So sometimes I tell people, if they ask me that question 4 years ago, I had many challenges. Because the major challenge, obviously, is finance when you're starting. But normally I tell people nowadays I can say we don't have financial challenges, business has broken even. To get business to break even, that's the hardest thing. Business has broken even, so we have positive cash flows. I'm trying to identify
what opportunity lies out there.
Okay, the opportunities are there. First of all, the opportunities we want to. You know, there's even better source of income for such a facility, and revenue if you now move from right now doing outpatient to inpatient, be able to do maybe have a theatre where you can do surgeries, and actually at the end of it is the next 5 years, the target is to have an inpatient facility. With that one, obviously, now comes the challenges of the capital to invest in the infrastructure. It requires maybe seeing how we can get financed for an extra building. The compound we still have to be able to get that building up, equipping maybe putting up a theater, expanding the services. In other words, just broadening the services from outpatient to inpatient, pre-admission, theatre, surgeries. Yes.
Okay.